Clear. So this one is lecture number 4, and here we will talk about probability law. So there would be two different kind of law. Right now just we will deal with the sample space. Later we will have another approach in case of random variable as well. So there we will see another scenario. So right now I told that if you perform an experiment, then you have to specify all possible outcome, and if you collect all possible outcome, then you are getting a sample space. How? It is a collection of all possible outcome. All possible outcome. That means simply you can say that sample space happens to be a set containing all possible outcome. Okay, so you have already seen this one. So generally if you perform tossing a coin, then if you toss your experiment is toss a coin, then how many members the sample space would have? Toss a coin. Only two, head and tail. Okay, if you throw a dice, then how many members would be there? Six. Regular dice generally having three faces, six faces. So if you throw a dice, then it will have sample space. The outcome we will denote it by the face number that coming, that one is appearing on the face. So generally the number happens to be 1, 2, 3. 1 is talking about face 1, 2 is talking about face 2, 3 is talking about face 3, and 4 is talking about face 4, and 6 is talking about face 6. So these are the outcome. So if you suppose I am giving a task that you play Wheel of Fortune, and there the number, that means where the counter will stop somewhere between 0 and 1 on the circumference there would be a number. So if you talk about Wheel of Fortune, then and circumference is, suppose it is a 1, some unit circumference of wheel we are taking, Wheel of Fortune. That means the counter may, what will happen? The counter may stop anywhere in the interval 0 to 1. So if you run a Wheel of Fortune, then what would be sample space? It is a little bit complicated. So it is like this way. This one is Wheel of Fortune with the circumference 1, unit circumference. So circumference is 1. So simply if your counter is here at 0, this point you are called, this one is the center. Okay. Center C. This one is 0 position. If you run, then just deviate Wheel of Fortune a little bit. So it will start from here, it may stop here, it may stop here, it may stop here, it may stop here. If you spin the Wheel of Fortune, it may stop anywhere in the counter, this counter, call it represented by arrow, this arrow line. So it may stop anywhere on the circumference. So tell me, so one experiment, once you one spin would be equivalent to one experiment. So this here, with respect to each experiment we are getting an outcome. So what would be value of outcome? Generally we denote it by a small letter. So outcome would be any number between what? Real number 0 and 1. So simply if I ask what is the sample space, sample space would be this unit interval 0 to 1. So definitely you see here what kind of difference you observe in these two, in these three kind of random experiment. So what you observe here? Here you observe there are only two outcomes. So you simply you can term this sample space is finite. it is a finite set, because we can count how many outcomes are there, possible outcomes they are there. So it is a finite. Likewise, this one is having 6 outcome, so you can simply turn this one is a finite set. This sample space is a finite set. Okay, and here it is a finite set. Like if you come here, how many outcomes are there in this Wheel of Fortune game? Call it experiment 1. This one is experiment 2. This one is experiment 3. How many outcome you observe here in this third experiment? Infinite, definitely infinite. So again, if you talk about infinite set, there would be two kind of infinite set. One infinite set that would be countable, another would be uncountable. Have you heard that word countable or uncountable? What is meaning of countable? Yeah, simply from the literal meaning you can simply say that. But if you are just talking about from that layman meaning of countable, then it is not giving what computational framework of the concept countable set. So mathematically, how you can visualize? So that thing we will talk first. So I will talk here countable set. So infinite set generally happens to be two kind of infinite set. One is generally, if you are taking a finite set, that always happens to be countable set, because there are a finite number of elements, so easily you can count. Okay, there is no issue. But if you talk about countable set, then talk about from infinite set perspective. So if you take an infinite set, there would be two kind of infinite set. One would be countable set, another would be uncountable set. So countably infinite set we will talk in general. That would be very interesting in application point of view. So if you take in a infinite set, generally it happens to be two kind of infinite set. So another experiment I can talk here. So suppose everyone might have already aware of dart game. Are you aware of dart game? Dart, that we are throwing dart on the board. There would be some kind of board. Generally it happens to be circular board. So if you try to play a dart game, and suppose if your board is like this way, it is like this way, it would somewhere it would be centered at this would be centered, one suppose one is the center. So again, if I ask regarding this experiment, then sample space would be what would be sample space? What would be sample space? Yeah, so complete circle, when we are calling it circle, and then it would be just circumference, it includes circumference. So talk about directly, you can call it disk, any point on the disk. So this is the disk. When you call it disk, or simply you can say that including circumference, circle inside, also inside of the circle, also you can say that. So it is not a legitimate word to use inside the circle only. A better word is disk. Call it disk. So the complete disk, it would be sample space when you throw a dice. So again, this one is a infinite set. So if you take infinite set, there are two possibility. One, it would be countable. Another, it would be uncountable. I haven't taken an example of countable set, countably infinite set. So we need to understand what is meaning of countable. Understanding is very simple. That's why I had already given hint that I discuss about whether are you clear about sequence or not. Or if you are clear about sequence, then easily you can visualize countable set. Also, you can visualize uncountable set. The sequence is playing very important role in order to quantify countable set or uncountable set. Okay, so that's your sequences. So suppose you are having an infinite, countably infinite set, then suppose call it S. Then that set can be written as a single sequence. Simply you can write, if your set happens to be countably infinite, then you can write that set in the form of a single sequence. Remember that I am talking about single sequence. So what is sequence? Anyone would like to, if you suppose you are having an uncountable set, you can't write that set in the form of a single sequence. You can't write that. It is not possible to write in a form of single sequence. It is not possible. If you said, this one is a very simple definition of countable set from the visualization perspective, what we call it. So when you are able to write a set in the form of a single sequence, what does it mean? That means every element or every outcome of the set has been written in a proper sequential order. So you can say that which element of the set is the first, which one is the second, which one is the third, and likewise, which one is the nth one. So you can always talk about. So this is meaning of countable set. So and what is meaning of a sequence? Anyone would recall what is meaning of sequence? What is sequence? You are talking about arrangement. So arrangement, whether arrangement is having a meaning of order or not. Definitely order is playing an important role. But if you talk about sequence, there is a very simple kind of meaning. You can talk about sequence as a function. It happens to be a function. And here, the domain of sequence always set of natural number. So it is a function which is defined from set of natural number to real number. Range would be, or codomain would be real number, and range would be subset of real number. So and we define a sequence from n to r, where n is natural number, and we denote it by sequence by x equal to, remember that x is a function, and x is a function. We denote a sequence by x equal to this bracket, within bracket xn we are putting. This xn we are calling it nth term of the sequence. This one is more abstract representation of a sequence, nth term of the sequence. And if someone want to see more explicit form of this sequence, then just open up the terms of the sequence and again, but don't lose this bracket. So you will say that first term x1, second term x2, but always you put in, if you are saying that sequence, always put in bracket, and it will go up to infinity. X3 and xn, likewise it will go up to infinity. So this one is sequence. And what is the difference between this representation and this representation? If I call element in within curly bracket, anyone may highlight what is the difference between this representation? I am calling this representation one, and this one is the representation two. What is the difference or similarity between these two references, representation, whether these two are same or something else? Anyone? Anyone just try to highlight it? Just try. It is not like that I am going to scold you. Whether second one is a sequence and first one is a sequence. Yeah, rightly you pointed out. Very nice. Second one, it is just a set, and you can say that it is a range of sequence. It is having relation with sequence, but simply we can't say that it is a sequence. It is a range of sequence. That means these values has been taken by this sequence, and this is the first representation is a sequence. There is an order relation, always bracket, always talking about order relation. When we talk about curly bracket, then it is talking about what? It is talking about set, just a set of collection of elements. So likewise, if you, someone is saying that you are writing like this way, minus 1 to the power n or simplistic simple one. It is okay. That would give a proper definition. The difference. Okay, minus 1 to the power n. Okay, and another write minus 1 to the power n. Then you will easily see the difference. Here minus the bracket, in bracket we put it minus 1 to the power n. So what does it is talking about? If you take n equal to 1, minus 1 to the power 1 is minus 1. If you take n equal to 2, minus 1 to the power 1 is 2. And if you take 3, minus 1 to the power 3 is minus 1, and likewise. So you are getting infinitely many terms of the sequence here, representation. This we call it sequence. But if you open up here this one, take several power of n, then what will happen? If you take n is odd, then you will get minus 1. When n is even, then you will get 1. So this is having only two members, but this representation is having infinitely many members. That's why this one is a sequence. So sequence is always, that's why I'm saying that sequence is always a function, and this is talking about range of the sequence. So range may be finite, may be infinite, depends upon what kind of function, sequence or function you are defining. If I'm asking one question, someone is defining a function like this way, defined from A to B. So tell me, if I write f of x, what we will call it? Is it a function? If you are defining function like this way, f of x is a function or not? Anyone? Anyone just try to point out whether f of x is a function or not? Definitely x is, I'm writing it, x is coming from domain A. Just now tell me again, f of x is a function or not? Not, it is not. This function happens to be a rule. This f only we are calling it function. This rule we are calling it a function. F of, when you are taking an argument x and applying this rule over that x, then it becomes a member of B. So it is just a value. We say that it is a value. It is a, it becomes a value. It is in the codomain. It is a, just a value of the function. So it, this one is not function. The rule is function. This f is a function. So whenever someone is saying that a square root of x, then a square root is the function. A square root of x is not function. A square root of x is just a value of the value, what value under the function what we are getting. That means image of, simply we say that a square root of x is what? It is the image of x. So what is the rule through which you got this square root of x? The rule is this square root. So this is the rule, that is the function. So always remember that you identify what is the function. Don't call f of x a function. That one is a misconception. F of x just, it happens to be value of argument x under the rule f. Always call it what is the rule. Under that rule you try to get a value of the argument. Argument will be mapped to that value f of x. So x has been mapped to f of x. So f of x is the value. That's why f of x falls in the range. So same concept is coming here like this way. So likewise, remember that x, this notation I have taken as a what? This is a rule. This is a function. It is defined by like this way. And when we take a specific value, then it becomes a member of range that falls here. These are the value. So that is the difference between function and functional value. Also you can call it for f of x functional value as well. So just recall those minor kind of detail in order to understand further things. So we will discuss today in detail about the probabilistic modeling, and all these things I recall it from math 1. And if someone is not feeling again comfortable, you can go and look that calculus course in parallel I'm offering to first semester regarding all those basic concepts. These are actually these are very much helpful kind of concept. It will help a lot. So here I will talk about recap, and that means as a part of recap I am discussing countable and uncountable set. I will talk about few proof as well. So later we will discuss about probability law. So very simple kind of law will come, uniform law, that in last class I had already introduced equally likely situation. So uniform principle we will discuss in detail in order to compute probability. This law is very much important, and this law is having different structure, depends upon that nature of sample space. If sample space happens to be discrete set, then the corresponding law, uniform law, we will call it a discrete uniform law or equally likely situation, simply we will call it. Again, if our sample space is continuous in nature, that is not discrete. Continuous in nature, simply we can say that everyone might have already gone through Riemann integration. Have you gone through or not? Riemann integration? In math 1, have you gone through Riemann integration? That one is a computational approach to deal with integration. Riemann, anyone? Have you gone through or not? Anyone just say yes or no. Anyone just recall, have you gone through Riemann integration or not? So can you recall what is the basic thing there? What you do? Just you take an interval, suppose a function is defined over an interval, f is defined in an interval from a to b to r, okay. Then what you do, your first step is that you do partition of the given interval in a b. You do partition, that means if you imagine take it like this way, this point a is here, this point b is here, then you do partition. So you come up with your partition like this. First point you are calling it x0, second point you are calling it x1, third point you are calling it x2, and likewise xn minus 1 and last point you are calling it xn. Okay, so you have just introduced n plus 1 point in this interval, and hence you are having n number of sub interval, n number of sub interval. So those sub interval happens to be x0 to x0, x1, x1, x2, likewise here xn minus, I am talking about uniform law here. So these are the sub interval. If you take union of these interval, then union would be equal to the interval AB. And if you talk about intersection of any two sub interval, there would be no common element except the endpoint, common endpoint. Like here regarding sub interval x0, x1, x1, x2. So only x1 is the common point, otherwise all these are disjoint partition of the interval AB. So what is the common thing we observe here? We put here that the length of any sub interval is what? Delta, common. All the sub interval is having length same. So what is meaning of same? Uniform, we call it uniform length. or uniform division, simply you can call it xk minus 1 xk. All are having same length. So we took a partition with uniform length, same length. So here when we will have that sample space as a continuous set, then we will talk about the elementary kind of event would be what it would be, sub interval of equal length. And if you take a sub interval of equal length, then what is the meaning of equally likely assumption there? Every sub interval of equal length would have same probability. Likewise, if you take discrete set, then you can easily point out, put all the outcome of this experiment in a single sequence, so that you can talk about every outcome is having the same probability in case of discrete. But if you come in continuous, then here you will say that it is not like that. You directly can't deal with the individual outcome there in case of continuous sample space. You have to deal with some kind of sub interval you have to come up with. So that one is coming with respect to partition approach that you had already gone through in the process of defining Riemann integration. So same concept. So this one is the uniform partition, what we are calling it when we talk about one. So these are the elementary kind of approach in order to deal with the continuous kind of set. AB is a continuous kind of set, that means it is one kind of interval set. So that's where we are discussing in detail. So here we will discuss in detail regarding few more things that how to come up with. I should avoid this example. It is part of that again same problem, assigning identifying outcome of a sample space. And after that we will discuss continuous and discrete set. So suppose we are having a experiment and where we are defining two different kind of things. Two different kind of things we will define, and with respect to two different approach, we will see different sample space. So consider a game of 10 successive coin tosses. So if you are tossing a coin 10 times successively, okay, and what kind of things we are putting it here, information we are putting that you will receive $1 for each time if head comes up. So if you are performing 10 successive coin tosses, 10 number of tosses are there, and you will get $1 each time a head comes up, otherwise nothing. Okay, so here consider a game. Okay, there is another game. This one is with respect to same set of situation. We are playing another game. Call, consider a game of 10 successive coin tosses where we receive $1 for every coin tosses up to including the first heads come up. Okay, then what will happen here? This one is different game. So we will receive $1 for every coin toss up to including first toss, first time head is coming up. Then we will receive $2 for every coin toss up to the second time a heads come up. A head comes up. Come. That means dollar amount per toss will be double each time if head is coming again. Okay. So that is the, this one is a separate game. So simply if I ask what is the sample space of this one and what is the sample space of this? Anyone? So before identifying sample space, how you can identify outcome? What would be outcome of first game and what would be outcome of second game? Anyone can point out? So no idea. So here you can talk about layer wise information. So there are 10 successive coin tosses. So in first toss you will get either head or tail. After first toss there would be second toss, again head or tail, again I go with this chain only. Again in third you will get head and third toss you will get head and tail. Again fourth toss you will get head and tail. Fifth toss you will get head and tail. Sixth toss you will get head and tail. Seventh toss you will get head and tail. Eighth toss you will get head and tail. Ninth toss you will get head and tail. Tenth toss you will get head and tail. Then in first question, if you try to point out, we just focus on how much dollar we receive with respect to each toss. So if you are here, if you are getting head, then you will get $1. If you are getting tail, then you will get $0. So that means what is the maximum dollar you will get in 10 successive toss? Anyone? Anyone? Just what would be 9? No, it is not just here you are performing 10 successive toss. Just you are performing 10 toss. Number of tosses are 10. That one is the fix. That one is fixed. So how much dollar you will get in maximum? $10. Nice. And minimum, how much dollar you will get? $0. So simply here, if you talk about sample, that outcome, it is varying from. So definitely actual outcome would be what pattern of a sequence of head and tail. Actual outcome, if you point out like this way, this situation is coming like some situation. So everywhere you are getting tail. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. But here outcome is that the amount is outcome, how much outcome you are getting it. So how actual in this problem, actual outcome is the amount, total amount, aggregate amount. So if you are observing this kind of pattern, this is the what implicit outcome, then what would be explicit outcome? Explicit outcome would be how much amount you got. So here in all the tosses in 10 successive coin tosses, in every toss output was tail. So overall output would be, I'm talking about overall output would be here 0. Likewise, if you get head in every toss, the overall output would be 10. So that's way, if you talk about what is the sample space for the problem 1, game 1, it would be. So you have to find meaningful outcome. It is not like that what is the meaningful outcome, just you have to come up with what would be meaningful. So here meaningful outcome would be 0, 1, 2, 3, or simply possible output, so you can call it 1. So it will go up to 10. There are 11 number of outcome. Now come to problem 2. What would be sample space here? What are the outcomes first here you have to identify? What would be outcome after complete 2 to the power? Here, remember, focus on this. You receive $2 for every coin toss up to second time head is coming up. Second time, like if you are having output like this way, head, tail, tail. Everywhere tail. So second time head came up. Second time head came up. Okay. So definitely you will get $2. If only one time head is coming, then you will get $1. But second time head is coming, you will get $2. Further head is coming, you will get, it will be doubled. Again, after this head, again you are getting head somewhere, then it will be double, $4. So that amount will be doubled each time a head is coming up. It is the doubling is happening. So here that order of head is very much important. Order that it is, so we have to deal with not just how much amount would be our final outcome. We have to focus on what is the order of head and tail. So actual outcome, actual that outcome after performing all these 10 successive coin tosses, that would be effective here. That would be our ultimate outcome. So outcome is, it would be just like this way. Here you can say that tail. So this would be actual one outcome. This and roll up here. Simply you can say that with respect to this outcome, how much amount you will get? $1. But if you talk about this outcome, how much amount you will get? Yes. Each time it double. So here, if situation is like this way, $1. If you are getting $2 here, $2, and then it, for this head, it is coming again one head, $4 and $8, and to the power something will come like that. That approach. So that's where these are the actual outcome with respect to that the amount will match it with the outcome. Yeah. So that would be say, this one is the actual outcome. Outcome, it is not just we are counting the amount, we are counting outcome, we are writing outcome like in this framework. So that's why for second experiment outcome would be this. So you can see that how many member would be there, how many element would be there in this sample space. That means simply talk in 2 to the power 10. So 1000, yeah. In for CSE student, this 1024. Nice. So that's where you can see that here sample space is having just 11 number of outcome. Here the sample in the second game problem, that experiment looks similar. That situation we have already changed, information we have changed. So that's where we are getting more number of outcomes. So and the outcomes looks different. Okay. So these are the perception, how to come up with the outcome. You have to just understand all these. So this one was part of last class. I should cover in last class, could not cover, but here again I'm discussing another part, important part of this lecture, that countable set and uncountable set I will talk. So I had already discussed that countable set, simply that you are putting all the member of the set in a single sequence. That is the simple meaning of countable set. So if you talk in that more mathematical way, so if there exists a bijection, or simply we can say that one correspondence between a set of natural number and the given set, then simply we will call that set, it is a countable set. So suppose we are having a set like this way, omega, we are having a set and there are various members, and if you easily find a path through that, we can say that it is first element, this one is second element, this one is third element, fourth, fifth, fifth, likewise. We can properly put all the element in a proper sequence, in a single sequence. Remember that I am talking about in a single sequence, like this way, A1, A2, A3, likewise. So we are able to put all the arrange or make a chain of all the element in a single chain of element of the set, and in such a way that set has been represented into a single sequence, then we say that that set happens to be a countable set. Otherwise, it would be uncountable set. That means if we fail to represent a set in form of a single sequence, then simply we will say that that set would be not a countable set, uncountable set. So example, simply you can take it like this way. If you take integers, and or if you take integer like this way, integer and put the integer member like this way, 0, 1, minus 1, 2, minus 2, 3, minus 3, like this way, then easily we can observe that there would be a bijection map from set of natural number to n, such that this x we are writing in term of a sequence xn. And what is xn here? Xn we are defined like this way. Xn is defined like this way. That means simply we say that n is the domain. So here you can say that through this map, if you are taking a natural number, it will start from here 1, 2, 3, 4. So take even numbers and divide. We know that even number are but multiple of 2, so you can easily divide even number by 2. So divide even number, then if you divide even number, then the 2, take 2, 2 is an even number, and if you divide by 2, you will get 1. So even numbers are mapped to positive integer. If you take 4 and divide by 2, then it would be what, 2. And if you take odd number and subtract odd number by minus 1 and divide by 2, after that take negative. So that will, the odd number would be mapped to negative integer. So like take 3, divide, subtract from 1, 3 minus 1 is 2, and divide it by 2, after that take negative. So simply you say that 3 minus 1 divided by 2 minus, so it becomes, so 3 will map to minus 1, likewise 5 will map to minus 2, 6 will map to 3, 7 will map to, so you can take it like this way, 6 will map to 3, and 7 will map to minus 3, likewise, then and 1 will map to, we are not getting a explicit representation of this one, so 1 will map to, 1 is remaining here, so 1 will map to 0. So in that process we observe that every natural number is having 1-1 correspondence with integer. Through this, if you talk about functional approach, this is the functional approach, you can say that. So we can say that a set of natural number is having bijection with set of integers, and hence integers, every number of integers can be written in a single sequence, and this member nth term can be given by this way. Xn is defined by this formula, you can see that this is the formula of Xn. Okay, and so we are able to write this element of Z in a single sequence form, you can easily, so that's where Z is a, it is a countable set. And now someone is saying that you might be already aware of that, if you are having a bijection, then bijection is always invertible. Then that means if you find a map from Z to N, what would be that? So easily you can define that, treat as a homework. You define a map representing capital. I'm taking here, when I'm taking double here double line that represent a set of a specific number, and we take just capital letter that represent a map or something, it depends upon what we want there. So we are defining a map, Z is a map from set of natural integers to natural number. So again here Z would be a sequence, and we denote it by Zn under the bracket, or where Zn is defined by this way. What is Zn? Or Zn or Zj, you can talk it like this way. J, you might have already seen that set of natural number, every member of natural number we denote by n, but if you are having integers, we generally denote integer by z. Some Greek word or some word is associated with the integers, that jhelum or something like that, that's where z is coming, so that is the meaning of that. So here I would like to say simply invertibility is very much easy, you can point out. That means take here integers like 0, 1, 2, 3, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, both are going up to positive infinity and negative infinity, and we can easily say that here we are saying that the positive integers are mapped to even numbers, even natural numbers. So only among the natural number we can talk it even number and odd number. So this situation is coming, this one is 2, this one is 3, this one is 4. So Here we can talk about one, that one is a positive integer. It is mapped to one is a positive integer. So one is mapped to, here we can call it simply we can say that here, like this, take 0 is mapped to 1. And z is positive, then it would be mapped to twice of 1 is mapped to 2, that 1 is a positive integer, 2 is mapped to 4, 3 is mapped to, where 3 is odd number, so that would map to what we call it odd number. 3 is a positive number, it would be mapped to odd, twice of 3 is 6, take it 5. And if z is negative, if you take z equal to minus 1, where it will map under this function, it becomes 2 plus 1, 3. So minus 1 will map to 3, minus 2 will map to 5, minus 3 will map to 7, likewise. So again, you can see that inverse map from z to n. Likewise here, I'm talking about the map from n to z. You can get it here, map from z to n. So always try to find that kind of map in order to see countability between two set. Okay, so here this map is coming like this way, so that one is already defined here. So here likewise also, simply if you take set of natural number or simply positive integer, by default it will be what, map to n through bijection. And what would be the sequence would be just defined by this way, xn equal to n. So very simple kind, obvious kind of approach you observe here, set of positive, regarding set of positive integer. Okay, now talk about joint occurrence of natural number in together, that means cross Cartesian product of n cross n. Do we see any bijection between natural number to this n cross n? Anyone would like to point out what would be the explicit form of this nth term? How we can define this bijection? Anyone? Between set of natural number to Cartesian product of natural number, how we can find bijection? Okay, give name. Let us give name to this. 1, this point would be 2, this point would be 3, this point would be 4, this point would be 5, this point would be 6, this point would be 7. The one n we are taking along the horizontal axis, another n, Cartesian product, meaning of Cartesian product geometrically, if you are willing to visualize, the visualization is happening like is this two dimensional array. Another n, second n we are taking along vertical axis, and this would be also again 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we'll go on something like that. So it is a contour approach. Contour had given this kind of approach. So how we can find a bijection between n to n cross n? Anyone? Anyone would like to suggest? If not possible, then see the path. So this point would be 1, 1, or you can put like this way. 1, row wise, more in 1, 2, 3, 4, first row, and one time you are writing it like this way, 6, 7, it will go something like that. Then again you are writing natural number again in second row, 5, 6, 7. This one is a contour diagonal approach, as people are calling. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so you will keep on going like this way. 1, Diagonal, it would be there would be some missing thing here, diagonal. So I'm writing it like this way. So diagonal, there would be missing thing. What would be that? Here you have to smartly find out a path like this way. So here you can go like this way. Okay. Or like okay, I did something. I should write like this way. So 1, 1. I should take order pair. It is not here. Order pair would be here. Order n cross n we are taking. Member would be what kind of? How can we write it? Definitely n is having infinitely many element. So point out all the order pairs. So how we can write all the order pair in a proper order? So can we can define a bijection. So take then there would be some missing element. Just wait for just complete writing this. Then you will see that. So I am taking this first coordinate from this n. And after that, we are taking all the possible member of n in the second coordinate. So in that process, we are getting infinite this infinite sequence. You are going up to infinity. 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4. Even you can write it 1, 4, and you will go on like this way. In second row, what we do take now one is has been already exhausted. We'll take 2. So 2, 1, 1 is coming from second end, and then 2, 2, then 2, 3, then 2, 4. Then in third row we take 3 from first n, and we will make a third row 3, 1, 3, 2, 3, 3, 3, 4. Likewise, it will go on. Likewise, again take 4 from first n, and you will make order pair 4, 1, order pair 4, 2, order pair 4, 3. And you will go on like this way. Order pair 4, 4, and you will go on, and that means you again getting a infinity cross infinity kind of array. Okay, one varies from 1, 2. One is varying this this varying from varying along columns, and this one is varying along variation. You can observe another second coordinate varying along row. So what you do, you define a weight kind of approach through you define a path like this way. So here weight, what would be sum of these two entry? 2, and after that 2, 3 is coming. So 1 plus 2 would be 3, and 2 plus 1 would be also 3. Then 3 plus 1 would be 4, 2 plus 2 would be 4, and 1 plus 2 would be 4. 1 plus 3 would be 4. Then 1 plus 4 would be 5, 2 plus 3 would be 5, 3 plus 2 would be 5, 4 plus 1 would be 5. Likewise, you can go like this way. This is the path. So you can in path, you can put it weight here to pass a line. So put, so this one you can call it weight 1 is associated with A1. So no, weight is 2 here, not 1. Weight is 2 here. Weight 2 is mapped to A1, weight 3 is, all these are mapped to A2, weight 4 has been mapped to A3. So likewise, you are getting a path, so that in that path you can put all the element of n cross n in that path. So that means simply you are able to write this one in a single sequence. N varies from 1 to infinity. So you are able to write. So you are getting a proper path. So that's why n cross m is also a countable set, because you are willing able to write that in a single sequence. So that's why it is a n cross n is a countable set. It is having a bijection with n set of natural number. So that is the approach. So I think it might be clear to everyone geometrically. Same thing you can visualize, like you can go this one would be 1 1. So from 1 1 you will go 2 1, then 1 2, then 1 2 2 here, and likewise here 3 1. So you have to keep on moving like this way. So like this way you have to keep on moving. You are getting a path. You can see that no single point would be left due to this movement. There keep on move. Okay, there would be no single point would be left here. It will go up a little bit. So there is no single left, you haven't left any point. So you always able to trace out what sequencing. You are getting a sequence. You are getting a sequence through this path, you are getting a sequence. You can term it as A1, this point is A2, this point is A3, this point is A4, and likewise you can term all these points in a proper ordering, and you are able to express n cross n in a single sequence. So that is the approach of meaning of countable set. So n cross n is also a countable set. Anyone can point out what is z cross z, whether it would be a countable set or not? Anyone? Z cross z is a countable set or not? Don't take much time, just think over it. Anyone? This is a map in just in first quadrant. If you expand it through all the four quadrant, then initially you will see that it is there would be a proper sequencing from these two shape of natural number or vice versa. Because always you will observe bijection, and hence bijection is always invertible. So you always get, again you will get z cross z to n. So it is a, again z cross z, it is a countable set. You can remember that again z cross z is a countable set. Anyone may comment over set of rational number, is it a countable set or not? Anyone? No. How you write a rational number? You write it like this way. It is a ratio of two integers, p by q, such that p q must be integer and q should not be zero, otherwise it won't be defined. Must be integer. So z notation we have to take. And we are putting more condition, one more condition. Q should not be zero. So what is p by q? P and q. P is an integer, q is an integer. So it is somewhat what? Z cross z. I would like to hear z star. What is meaning of that? In this z we are putting leaving zero here. In second z we are not, z star means it is not having zero element, because in denominator we can't see zero, we don't want zero, we have just subtracted zero from z. So it is somewhat like z cross z. And we had already seen that z cross z is having bijection with n, and hence we can say that q is also having bijection with n. So set of rational number is also countable. It would have a bijection with n, and hence we can say that set of rational number also can be written in a single sequence. this one is a very important kind of result. You will get benefit of this result later a lot. So again, set of rational number is a also countable set. But if someone is saying that set of real number, is it a countable set? No. We can't find any bijection between set of rational number and set of real number. There is no possibility of bijection between set of rational number and set of real number, and hence we can say that real number is not countable. And even something more than don't go to real number. If you take any interval, suppose take unit interval 0, 1, okay, and there is no bijection between set of rational number to unit interval 0, 1, there is no bijection. So simply interval 0, 1 is not countable. It is not a countable set, uncountable set. Those are uncountable set. So here, just I had discussed a little proof of a rational number. If you are taking a rational number between 0 and 1, then easily you can put those all these rational number in the form of a single sequence, which are between 0 and 1. 1 by 2, 1 by 3, 2 by 3, 1 by 4, 2 by 3 by 4, 1 by 5, 2 by 5, 3 by 5, 4 by 5. Here you can ask a question, why not 2 by 4? Why? Because 2 by 4, if you simplify, it would be 1 by 2. So again, 1 by 2 is there. So that's why we are not taking that. Likewise, you just keep on changing the denominator and take all possible numbers in the numerator before that denominator. And you will see that all these are rational number which falls between 0 and 1 and having a single sequence representation. So easily you can put it like this way. So one that I discuss it from order the Cartesian product, and another you can talk it like this way. Now come to discuss about uncountable set. Simply a set which is having no bijection between the set and set of natural number, then simply we will call that set is uncountable. So example is very trivial kind of example I would like to take. So if you take an interval 0, 1, unit interval 0, 1, definitely it is not a countable set. There is no bijection between set of this set 0, 1 and natural number. There is no bijection. We can't find. So a proof is given here by contour argument. That means if you suppose that 0, 1 is countable, proof by contradiction, what we say that suppose interval 0, 1 is countable, what does it mean? That means we are able to put the element of this interval into a single sequence. We are putting like in a single sequence, and the sequence is taken in such a way we are putting further assumption that only the in the decimal representation these sequential member are represented in term of 3 and 4 only. These are containing, suppose another assumption we have taken it. So this decimal representation of these numbers are having involved only 3 and 4. Okay, not other than 3 and 4. Okay. So what will happen then if you take few member of this sequence, like x1 we are taking it, definitely it composed from 3 and 4 through in the decimal representation 0.343443 like this way. Definitely x1 is from the interval 0, 1. Take another member x2, it is definitely composed from 4 and 3 like this way, 4443443 like this way. And definitely we can observe that here after the decimal here 4 is coming, but here after decimal 3 is coming. So the x1 and x2 are totally different, and we are taking x3 like this way, 3343444. So x3 is again different member of the this interval. So likewise we are having various member of 0, 1 through the composition of 3 and 4 after the decimal. Okay, so and what is happening that now we are constructing a new element, how with the composition of 3 or 4 again. So we are constructing this number in such a way that here we in the x1 what we observe 3 is coming first, so in x in place of 3 we will take 4. Now here x2 in the second position containing 4, so in place of 4 here in x we will take 3. We will change the position, okay, in order to construct x. So by visualizing x1, x2, x3, okay. So anyhow we try to, if we can see here in x3 at fourth decimal, third decimal place 4 is there, so that's why we are putting 3. So we are constructing x in such a way x would be different from all of all these xi's. It would be different from all these xi's. So what does it happen? Here we are able to represent x as a decimal form, just involving only 3 and 4. But x is different from all these xi, and we have taken assumption that xi is a countable. So what does it mean simply? It simply says that xi is not in the set S. So which is a contradiction of, which contradict our supposition that x is a countable. So this set can't be a countable. This interval can't be countable. So it is just, it may look very, what we call in mathematical rigorous kind of proof, but simply you can simply say that it is not a countable set. That means 0, 1 is an uncountable set, or any set which contains this one, definitely that would again becomes uncountable set. So that's where real number is also an uncountable set, because 0, 1 is an interval of real numbers, set of real numbers. So it is a real number would be also uncountable. So that is the perspective, and definitely you will find difficulty in order to establish uncountability of a set. So it is one just example, and I won't ask much question regarding how to prove uncountable set, but we will take in simple space. If there is an uncountable set, we have to proceed in a different way, and that leads to our discrete continuous set. So I am going to discuss about, do we have time? What is time? Okay, we are having time, so I would like to proceed further. So now here we will talk about probabilistic law. So countable set and uncountable set is already clear. So here probabilistic law, it would be defined in two different fashion, or two different viewpoint. One would be discrete fashion, another one would be continuous fashion. Discrete. So generally it happens to be either a finite set or countably infinite set. In layman way, but not it is a not a concrete definition. So either discrete set would be a finite set or countably infinite, like set of natural number. Or set of integer, countably infinite. Simply you can say that countable set. But remember that I will talk in detail later. And infinite set, other thing, there is a different set of natural number is coming here. Set of all finite set are coming here, and the set of integers are coming here, but rational is not coming, excluding q will not come here. And continuous set is what? Non-discrete set. That means it contains some interval or union of interval. Discrete set or continuous set. In layman way, I am talking in sense what you understand. So it contains interval or some interval. You can write it like this way. Contains. That means continuum of element, uncountable simply. Definitely, first criteria, it would be every continuous set always happens to be uncountable set. That one is the first prerequisite. Okay, first prerequisite for being uncountable set. And next in order to identify that easily, how you can identify if you take a set which contains an interval or what we call it union of interval, then simply you can say that that set would be countable set or union of interval. So that is one, that one is continuous set, union of intervals. Interval. So we are talking about the sample space, when a sample space is a discrete and when a sample space is a continuous. Then we will define a probability law. What is that? Suppose in the first situation, suppose a discrete set, a sample space is a discrete set. That will simply we say that discrete sample space. Okay. Then if you put law, that uniform law, then uniform law here in this case, we will talk about equally likely outcomes. So if whatever outcomes are there in that sample space, everyone is having a equally likely situation. Likely the probability of occurrence is same to every outcome in this discrete sample space. So suppose we are having a random experiment, and we assume each outcome is here equally likely to occur. Each outcome, remember that each outcome is equally likely to occur. That is the uniform law in discrete sample space. That means the associated probability measure is distributed uniformly. That we will see it here. What is meaning of uniformly? That same uniformly means same for every outcome. That is the meaning of uniformly. So consider in an intuitive way, before the experiment here, what we see in this discrete approach, that before even experiment is performed, we are equally certain for each outcome of the sample space. Equally certain, that means each outcome will come with the same probability. We are equally certain for each outcome. That means if you are taking any event A, then how we can find probability of A? Just we have to look, zoom out, what are the outcome there in that, how many outcomes are there in that event, and just sum the probability of those outcomes, that will give the probability of the event. So you just zoom out, what are the outcome there in that event, and through that we can calculate probability of the outcome. So equally likely situation, like if you consider a random experiment of throwing a dice, then we know that how many faces dice is having, how many sided, 6 sided. So natural sample space for this dice throwing would be omega containing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, and now under the uniform law or equivalent, so easily you can say that it is a discrete set because it is a finite set, discrete set. So another number of discrete set also you can define it like this way, that if every element happens to be a singleton element of the set, then you can say that that set would be a discrete set. What is the meaning of singleton element? Find the find that definitely a singleton set means you have to take any member of the set, and then there exists a neighborhood. Simplest neighborhood happens to be epsilon neighborhood, that we denote it by V or N. We are taking neighborhood is starting with a letter N. So take a epsilon neighborhood of that. Such that this epsilon neighborhood would be a singleton set one, contains only one element. If you take intersection with this set, it would be singleton set. That means every, if you are taking a point X from this set, and if you are trying to find an epsilon neighborhood of that set, epsilon is what? It is a small positive real number, as small as possible you can take it, you are free to take. So that's why existential criteria is there. So as much as small as someone, if someone is saying taking 0.001, it's fine. Then another one will come, and that person will take 0.0001. Like as much as a small you can handle, you can proceed with that. So that is the meaning of epsilon, as small as possible. So try to take a epsilon neighborhood, and if you do intersection with X, then you will observe that there is only one element, that X itself, it would be there. So that in that case we will say that X is a singleton element of X, and a discrete set is what? It is having all the, so always if you take one, always you can define interval like this way geometrically if you are willing to visualize. So 1 would be here, 2 would be here, 3 would be here, 4 would be here, 5 would be here, 6 would be here. So always you can visualize like this way. This one is epsilon, take it point less than 0.5 or less than point, or like point simply take it 0.1. So then with respect to that you will get interval like this one would be 1 plus epsilon. This one would be 1 minus epsilon. So you can observe that this interval is containing 1 itself of the this set omega. It is not containing other than 1 itself. So that's why 1 is a what? It is a singleton point of omega. Here epsilon, I'm talking here epsilon, you can take it 0.1. As small as possible, it depends upon your choice. Likewise, also you can define an epsilon neighborhood around 2, and that you, this point you will call it 2 plus epsilon, this point you will call it 2 minus epsilon. So again, this epsilon neighborhood is containing only 2 of this sample space, not other than 2. So 2 is also a singleton point. So likewise, if you take natural number, then again natural number is also having only singleton point, all the singleton point. Okay, but if you take interval, such scenario is not there. If you take even rational, then such scenario would be not there. So like if you take interval like here 0 1, if you're taking interval 0 1, then if you take any small interval sub epsilon neighborhood of 0, then definitely this part will, this point you will call it 0 plus epsilon, this point you will call it 0 minus epsilon. Okay, so this part will contain some element of what we call it interval. So 0 plus epsilon, definitely it will be in the interval 0 1. So we can say that this interval 0 1 is not having any singleton element, but if you take a finite set, it would always have singleton element. If you take set of natural number, it would always have singleton. If you take set of integers, that would always have what we call it singleton set. But if you take rational number would have limit point as well. So even more than that, if you take collection of all the limit point of a rational number, it would be equal to real number. So any real number is a limit point of this one, any rational. So that those are part of math 1. You can recall it from math 1, or you can watch calculus lecture later. You will see a lot of meaning of that way. So here definitely it is a discrete set, we can see that. So that's why we are applying uniform law. Due to discrete nature, it has been converted into equally likely outcomes. So that means how many outcomes we observe? We observe 6 number of outcomes. So each one is having equally likely situation, equally likely certain. That means simply you can say that probability of occurrence of one, that outcome one, is equal to probability of occurrence of 2, is equal to probability of occurrence of 3, is equal to probability of occurrence of 4, is equal to probability of occurrence of 5, is equal to probability of occurrence of 6. So till now we don't know what is the value of probability of 1. What is value of probability 2? But due to this equally likely situation, we come up with what that all these probability of each individual outcome happens to be same. So, okay, so this one is directly coming with respect to discrete probability law and discrete uniform probability law. It is coming now. After that, what we will do? We will apply that axioms of probability measure. What does it say? That simply first say that the probability of each outcome would be greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 1. So that one is, so definitely first it would be greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 1. You can write it just second. It say that sum of these probability, it is normalizing condition, sum of these probability would be equal to 1. If you sum the range over all the omega, then sum would be 1, normalizing property. So that means sum all these probability of p1 plus probability of p2, probability of p3, probability of p4, probability of p5, probability of P6, probability of all this sum of all these probability is equal to 1 due to probability second and third, there was that mutually exclusive. So combining these two property, we are getting probability of sum of all these probability is equal to 1. So solve these two equation. This one is call it equation 1, and this one is call it equation 2. If you summing all these probability, then you will see a numerical measure of this probability that would be equal to 1/6. So that's why I told that we are getting probability of 1 equal to 1/6, probability of 2 equal to 1/6, probability of 3 equal to 1/6. How we are getting it? Thanks to this equally likely situation and probability measure, the definition of probability measure. From the definition of probability measure, second one, definition of probability measure, combining those two, we come to see that probability of getting 1 is 1/6, probability of getting 2 is 1/6, so and 3 is likewise. So due to combining these two we are getting probability is equal to 1 by 6. So it is coming due to equally likely situation, equally likely outcome. So another example I would like to take with respect to discrete law. So if the sample space consists of finite number of possible outcome, then the probability law is specified by the probability of the event that consists of outcome as a single element. Okay, so I'm generalizing it. So suppose in the random experiment, if you are taking any event, then what we have to look, what kind of outcomes are there, what kind of outcomes are there. So you have to look for omega is the notation of outcome. These are the outcome in that event, and just sum up the probability of these outcomes and you will see the probability of the event, this event. What would be probability of this event? So you can denote it by this. You have to zoom out to what kind of outcomes there are in that event. So find the probability of those outcome and sum up all those probability of outcome, and hence you will get probability of the corresponding event. So you are free to write it like this way, probability of omega 1 only itself. There is no need to put a square, this curly bracket, if there is a single element. By default, you can put it omega 1 itself. That one is just a notation convention. Okay. So just I am generalizing it. Suppose if there is a sample of space, it consists of n possible outcome which are equally likely. All those are equally likely. Okay. So then probability of an event A, it would be given by how? It would be given by this empirical approach. That means we have to zoom out the event and we have to look what kind of outcome there are. What are the outcome there are? So we have to count the probability of occurrence of those outcomes. And we simply count the number of those outcomes which are happening in A, and we have to divide by all the possible number of outcomes. So this simply, in short, we say that number of possible outcome in event, specific event A, divided by all possible outcome. That means our sample space is containing all possible outcome. So this definition you are already aware of. So how this definition is coming? This definition is coming due to equally likely situation and due to discrete law, equally likely situation, and through probability definition of probability measure. So that's where it is coming directly from. Directly don't write like this way. So you will be asked how it is coming. It is coming through discrete law, that discrete uniform law or equally likely situation. So that